next day we are going to take a crash course on advanced Excel. I mean it crash because advanced Excel is a vast thing. So I'm going to familiarize some of the most important tools which can be used for your daily business life or anything. Okay, so we will start our session. First of all, I will introduce you some of the operators. Maybe most of you are aware of that. Anyway, I will introduce. That is plus hyphen is for subtraction. Division, forward slash is using for division, not the backward slash. In the keyboard, you will get two. And simple, very useful thing is ampersand. Caret symbol for exponentiation. That is, if you want to calculate, am I audible? So the order is evaluate items in the parenthesis. When we are giving formula to an Excel, it will evaluate the items inside the parenthesis. Then evaluate the ranges. Then next is evaluate the intersections. Evaluate unions. Perform negation. Convert percentages. Perform exponentiation. Perform multiplication and division. Perform addition and subtraction, evaluate text operators, perform comparisons. That is the order in which we, the Excel will operate. So in a formula, if we want to do the addition first, what we have to do is we have to give this addition operation inside a parenthesis. Otherwise, if there is a multiplication operator, then the Excel will calculate the multiplication process first, then only it will do the addition process. So if we need to do the addition first, then we have to give the addition operator inside the parenthesis. Okay, so that is regarding the operators. Then relative versus absolute cell references. So when you have used the Excel formulas, you have find it that when a constant value is in a specified cell, and we are copying the formula to a next cells, it will affect the whole formula. So in order to avoid that, we are using relative versus absolute cell references. I will show you what I'm what is the problem using this copying formula. Okay, then we can also use the external cell references. That is, we can use two Excel sheets at a time for using the formulas. Okay, so these are the some elementary thing. I just brush up the elementary things you have to be in knowledge. So we will start our session. How to see headings as you scroll around a report. That is, when you have a big Excel sheet. So the currently I'm showing the Excel sheet, that is sales report of 2019. Then when I go to the down pages, what happened is the headings vanishes. Yeah. So we cannot see the headings. Okay. So when I want to know what is this GHI mean for, I have to go to the first page itself. So when I am in the 10th page, then I have to go back to the first page to see the headings. So we can solve this problem using the method which is given as okay, in the view ribbon, okay, the view ribbon, you will get a freeze panes. freeze panes. In the view ribbon, freeze panes. Use the freeze panes. Okay. So then we get a freeze panes, free top row, freeze first column. So we can choose a whatever we need. So first we have to do is we have to take select the cell just below the heading. Okay, select the cell which is just below the heading. Then go to the freeze panes. Then click freeze panes. Okay, so there some bolded line will come there. That means that portion is fixed there. So when we scroll down, the heading will be there. So whatever be the other page, when we are in that 100th page also, the heading will be there. That is, we can see the headings wherever we are. Okay, so that is the use of freeze panes. That is the first thing we have done. So are you able to do the same? Okay, if anybody is not having the Excel file or Excel you can just write down the steps and you can do it yourself when you are free. Okay.
Hello.
Second. Okay.
Yes. Speaking.
Second thing is.
Yeah, actually, I was using my mobile. From my mobile, I was not able to get any audio. But later, I joined from a laptop. So now it's okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
So next we will move to the next thing. That is how to print titles at the top of each page. So when you are taking printouts of a big data file. Okay, when you are taking a printouts of big data files, you obviously find a problem that in the first page only we are getting the headings. Then in the consecutive pages there will not be any headings for the table. Okay, when most of you have faced the problem in your day-to-day life, so we can do the we can solve this problem also. That is in this page. When we are going to the next session. Please go to the next sheet. Every sheet contains different things. Okay. So currently I'm using the second sheet. So please note that I'm using the print heading sheet. Okay. So in order to use this file contains so many lines. So when I scroll down, the headings vanish. So in order to solve that, when we are taking the printouts, what we have to do is in the print page layout ribbon, in the page layout ribbon, use the print titles. In the page layout ribbon, use the print titles icon. Okay. Then so by clicking the print title, we will get a page setup menu bar. So here you have to give. There is in the third row, there is one thing is rows to repeat at top. And we have columns to repeat at left. We can give anything. So I'm giving these headings. That is sales rep, date, quota, sales. These things should be in repeated in every table, every page. So I'm giving this row as to repeat at the top and just giving print preview. So when we are getting, before taking any printouts, we have to go with the print preview. So this is the current page. Then when we move to the next page also, the headings are there. That is sales rep, date, quota, sales, all these headings are there. Okay, so that is the use of this method. So I will explain once more. That is, we have to go to the page layout ribbon, then use the print titles. Okay, once the print titles menu bar is coming, select the row which we want to repeat at every page, then just go through the print preview. So when the print preview is okay, then we can go with the printing option. Okay. So that is the second thing. Now we will move to the third. Copy a formula while keeping one reference fixed. That I have already told you. That is cell referencing, absolute cell referencing. Okay. So the sheet we are using is copy formula. The third sheet, copy formula. So this sheet contains region, product name, date of selling, quantity, unit price, and the sales tax. Okay, so first of all, I will do what is the usual way we are doing to calculate the total price. That is the quantity into the unit price into the sales tax amount. That is 106.5%. Okay, then what we are going to do this, usually what we will do, we will drag is, okay. So those who are not familiar about dragging, I will explain it. That is, whenever our cursor moves inside a Excel sheet, we will get three types of plus signs. That is, the one we are getting is the transparent plus sign. That means the cursor moving to select any cell. Okay, then when we move to the border of a cell, we will get a plus sign like this. You can view this. Okay, this plus sign means we can move the cell content to any place. Just moving the content. That is the thing which we are doing by this plus sign. Then the third one is mostly used for the formulas things. That is the bold plus signs. That will get only when we come to the corner, bottom corner side of the cell. Then when we drag the formula, what will happen is, okay, what will we see in the second column? The value is zero. What happens? We will go to the formula D5. The content of D5 is 10, okay. Content of E5, the unit price, okay. But what happened to the sales tax factor? It comes to the C2, cell C2. Cell C2 is empty. Okay, what we have actually need is we have to fix this cell for every formula. So that is the one we are going to do using cell referencing. So cell referencing is, go to the formula in the formula ribbon. Then C1 is the one which we want to fix. Okay. So before the C1, we fix a dollar sign. After the C1 also, we use a dollar sign. Okay. So before and after, we use a dollar sign and click the enter. Okay. Now we are going to copy the formula to the every cell. Okay, so we will go to the next second line. What happened is D5, E5, okay, but the C1 cell is constant. Okay, even we go to the 23rd line also, the C1 is constant there. Okay, so in order to avoid inserting this dollar sign, we can use the function key F4 also. That is, just go to the equation by clicking the F4 function key. F4 function key, just please note it. The function key used for the referencing is F4. So just pressing F4, we can take whichever referencing we need. This is absolute referencing. Okay, then this is the row referencing and this is the column referencing. Okay, so we can use which one is needed. So instead of manually inserting dollars, we can use the function F4. And we can copy the formula to the whole data set, and even at the bottom line, that is bottom line is the 566th row. Here also the formula, first two values are changing, but the last one is constant here. Okay, so that is the use of absolute referencing, cell referencing. So now we are going to the next session. So next is how to calculate sales in excess of a quota. Okay, so we have a sales data, we have want to find out whether it is excess of a quota. So for that we are moving to the next sheet, that is sales over quota. Okay, sales over quota, just do equal to sign, quota is 800 minus 666. Okay, so it shows, you have to do in the reverse way, that is sales minus quota. Okay, so what happened is we can see, that is this minus 134 shows it is less than the quota. Okay, when we drag the formula also, we can see, but there is an option which will tell you whether it is over quota or lesser quota. What we have to use is if condition. If condition. So if condition is like that, go to the next cell, equal to sign, if open the bracket, then logical test. I want to test this difference, that is sales minus quota. Okay, sales minus quota. So if it is a lesser value, what we have to check is, if the value is less than zero, we have to get a result like it is less than the quota. And if it is a positive number, we have to get a result like that it is over the quota. Okay, so what we have to do is D2 minus C2, okay, greater than zero. Then I want to get a result that if it is true, if it is a positive value, it is over quota. Okay, so text should be in quotes. Okay, so I close the quotes. Then if it is false, what I have to say is it is less than the quota. So close the bracket. So what we have done is, using if sign, we have checked the value, and if the value is greater than zero, it will print over quota, and if it is less than or equal to zero, it will print less than the quota. Okay, just press. Okay, so minus 134 means it is less than the daily quota. So when we drag the formula, it will automatically tell you what is the current situation for the second salesperson, Dan. For the second salesperson, he sold more than the quota, so we got over quota. Okay, then when in the case of Joe, he sold less than the quota, so it is less than the quota, like that. Okay, so we have used if condition. So the next thing is, how to join two text columns. So the symbol we are using is ampersand symbol, and the procedure is known as concatenation. Okay, ampersand symbol is used for concatenation operation. So now we are going to the next sheet, that is join text. So we have first name in the first column and the last name in the second column. I want to get the full name in the third column. Okay, so what I have to do is press the equal to sign, select first name cell, ampersand, second name. Now you will face a problem. There is Nora Jones. We expected a space in between, isn't it? That is first name, a space, then the last name. So in order to get the space in between, what we have to do is equal to sign, A2, ampersand. We have to insert a space also. So space also considered as a text. So whenever we want to add an extra text, we have to use the quotes. So inverted quotes, a space. Just press the space bar, then close the quotes, use the ampersand sign and the B2. Now we got Nora Jones with a space. Okay, so that is the method of using ampersand symbol for concatenation. So when we are dragging the formula, we can do the same thing for the whole data set. Then join text with a date or currency. Okay, so when we are making a bill, okay, so in this case I want to get a data like this. Please remit $14,975.20 before Friday, July 18, 2008. Okay, so after the bill I have to get this text. Okay, so what we have to do? So now we are moving to the next sheet, that is join date. Join date. So here is the bill. The bill date is 18/6/2008. I want to get the bill paid within 30 days. That is meant by the net 30. Okay, so within the next 30 days, I have to get the bill paid. So in the bill, I have to get the last date of bill payment. So here, so I have already told you, when we want to insert an extra text, you should use quotes. So I'm using quotes. Please remit. Please remit. So I'm closing the quotes, then using the concatenation symbol ampersand. Dollar, the amount we should come, isn't it? Then ampersand on or before, close the quotes, ampersand symbol, then the date plus 30. Okay. So the cell is not in the date format. That is why the date is not coming. So we have to change the format of the cell. Format cells. instead of that we can use this thing. Is some problem with this share. Okay, so for that we have to use this function also, that is text to function. So you can do this in a separate line. So in order to insert space, what we have to do is just press the space also. So please remit this much of amount on or before 7/18/08, that is 7th month, 30 days after the bill date. Okay, so for that what we have used is the function, that is text the bill date. Okay, bill date plus 1. So in either we can use the addition in a separate cell, or we can use the addition in the same function also, that is the date plus the 30 day. Okay, also shows the same thing. So it will give the 30 days and also in the format, that is MMDDYY. If we want to find show that year in full 2008 like that, then you have to use YYYY. Okay, so that is the way we can use the Excel to enter a text like this. That is the bill payment is on or before the 30 days after the bill date. Then, how to isolate the center portion of an account ID? So, most of the cases when we are going with the account details, we have to isolate. So, here, a company ABCD assigns an account ID SSXXYYY. We want to isolate the XX portion. Okay, only the XX portion we needed. So what we have to use is the MIT function. Okay, so we will go to the Excel sheet, account ID. So here equal to sign MIT function. MIT function is first we have to enter the text, that is the account ID. Okay, comma, starting number. Starting number is where we want to start the subsetting. Actually, we are subsetting the text. Okay, so where we want to start the subsetting. So the X portion is coming in the fifth position. 1, 2, 3, then the hyphen. So including that also. So we have 4 more spaces before the 6. So we have to the start number as 5. Then from the fifth position, how many terms we needed? That is the number characters we have to give. So I need 2 numbers, that is 6 and 0. So comma 2, close the bracket. Okay, so it isolated the portion 60 only. Okay, Then when we drag the formula, it will copy the same thing to the next cells also. Okay, if we want to isolate that last four digits, that is 6255, what we have to do is last five digits. So use the mid function, select the account ID, comma, which is the starting number, the 6225, that is 6 is the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8th number. So the starting number is 8 and I need 4 digits. Okay, that is the number characters. So close the bracket, 6255. Then when we copy the formula also, it will give the function. So from any text, we can subset the text which we needed using mid function. Then cleaning strange characters from text field. When you import data from an external data source, such as text files or web feeds, strange characters may come in with your data. Instead of trying to clean these manually, you can use Excel's clean function. Okay, when you are getting an email from an Apple mobile, you will get so many symbols which you are not familiar. Okay, so in order to clean that, we can use trim function. Trim, clean. Okay, so we will see what will happen using this one. So clean, here I have to give trim clean, then the text, close the brackets. Okay, so it removed all the unnecessary symbols which came using the clean function. So the function is trim, then within bracket clean, then the function, the text. Okay, then using the copy formula, we can do the same thing the other cells also. So that is the use of clean function, clean. Next is rank scores. Okay, you have four writers working on a project. Each week you need to report how many pages they have written towards their goal as given in spreadsheet. Write a formula that could rank them in high to low order. Okay, so here we are going to use two strategies. That is, first one is rank function, second one is VLOOKUP function. Okay, so the cell we are using is rank scores. Rank scores. So this is the data. The total pages they are used. So we have four persons: Tessa, John, Ashley, and Lee. And these are their pages. Okay. So first of all, I want to make a rank. In order to avoid manual ranking, there is an option in Excel that is rank. Okay. So equal to rank within bracket number, that is which value I want to rank it. So the page numbers is the ranking option. So I have to click the pages, comma. Then reference means with respect to the value of the whole pages, that is the pages typed by these four persons with reference to the number of pages, I have to rank the then descending or ascending. Okay, so I'm using ascending. One. Okay, so I got rank as 3. So is it correct? Tessa strand is 3. That is, I have given the option ascending. So when it is 0, okay, so Tessa's one is second rank. First one is Josh, second one is Tessa, third one Lee, and fourth one is Ashley. So we will see what will happen when we are dragging. Oh, something happened, isn't it? What will be the reason for that? We are dragging the formula. When it come to the third line, just go to the formula. What happened? Yeah, the cell referencing is changing. We have to make it constant, isn't it? So we have to do the absolute cell referencing. Okay, so first we have to go there. Then I have told you, in order to do the cell referencing, what we have to do? Press the F4 function. So F4, so the cell referencing came to the first range. Then go to the second range, press F4 once again. So now it came to the cell referencing, absolute cell referencing. Enter. Then copy the formula. What we got? Yeah, we got the rank as per the number of pages. First rank goes to Josh, second rank goes to Tessa, third Lee, and fourth one Ashley. Okay, so now we got the ranking, but I need a table which gives the rank in the order. Okay, that is 1, 2, 3. So here the rank is in the order 1, 2, 3. I want to get the names and the corresponding pages. So what we need is, first rank is Josh. So I need Josh here and his pages, this 247 point something. This number should come here. So for that, what we have to do is press VLOOKUP. Okay, VLOOKUP is the most useful thing in Excel. It is very, its use is unbounded. We cannot bound it to a single case. It is unbounded. You can use VLOOKUP in so many cases. I am introducing some minor cases also. Okay, VLOOKUP is like a C. This function itself is like a C. So VLOOKUP, close the bracket, lookup value. So I have to find the rank 1. That is, rank 1 is the lookup value, comma. Where I have to look for this rank? I have to look for this rank in the above table. So I have to select the whole table. Okay. Then, third one. So, okay, once Excel found that value, which cell you want to see? I want to see the name of the first ranked person. That is, in this table, it is the second column. So name comes in the second column. So 2. Then comma. Then it comes approximate match and exact match. Okay, if you need approximate match only, you can use true. If you want the exact match, you can use false. I need exact match. So false. Close the bracket. Enter. Okay, so the name came. First ranked person, Josh. Okay, and before dragging, what we have to do? The cell referencing change F4. Here also press F4, cell referencing change. So we can drag the formula here. What comes? Yeah, the date. Names are in the order. Second rank is of Tessa, third rank Lee, fourth rank is Ashley. Now we need the corresponding pages also. So do the same thing, that is VLOOKUP within brackets, lookup value, that is rank, comma, where we want to look up, that is the table, comma. If Excel found that value, what Excel have to show is the page number. So page number comes in the third column. So 3, comma. Then true or false? False, because I need exact match. Close the bracket, press enter. Yeah, the corresponding page came. Okay. Then here also do the cell referencing change. Then drag the formulas to every cell. So it's shown the whole case, isn't it? That is the corresponding page also. So in order to avoid manual calculation, Excel provides these things. So here we have introduced with two functions. One is rank, that is rank, and the second one is VLOOKUP. Okay, so we have used two functions simultaneously. Next is sorting with a formula. Okay, so I want to sort data. So for that, we have to go to the next sheet. Okay, that also we have done here. That is the case we have done using VLOOKUP. Okay, rank function, I have given these things in two different slides. So, and we have done it simultaneously. So in the first slide, it's telling about the ranking, and the second slide is about the VLOOKUP. We have done these two simultaneously, so there is no need of that. So it gives the explanation of VLOOKUP arguments. Okay, calculating age. Okay, that is also a very wonderful function, that is dated if. So for that, we are going to the sheet age. Okay, age. So in when we are using dated if, we have six options. That is when we are giving by, it gives it gives number of complete years in the period. Okay, that is, if I want the years, then if I want the months, I have to give M. If I want to give the get the D, dates, okay, D, then MD. MD means start, the difference between days in start date and end date. The months and the years of dates are ignored. Okay, so like that. So we have so many options. So what we have to do is, here date of birth is 16/5/1972. So I want to calculate his age. So the function is dated if. Dated if okay, unfortunately the dated if function is not coming here. I don't know what happened. I tried this thing, but I'm not getting this. Okay, dated if function is not coming. So we will go to we will do this tomorrow. Okay, I will check it and we will do it tomorrow. Okay, unfortunately it is not coming here. Maybe this slide also will not come because here also we are using dated if function. So we are moving to the next case. Calculate the date of nth weekday of a month. Okay. So whenever we are going to a hospital or some offices, we will get an appointment in the third Monday or sixth Wednesday, like that. So in order to find out that what we are doing is, we will scroll down this calendar. Okay. So in order to avoid that, we can use this function. This function is somewhat very lengthy. So what is the thing is, you can use copy. Okay. Because this function contains so many things. That is, nth occurrence. Nth occurrence means I want to get the second occurrence. Okay. So year is 2020. Month is January. January is done, denoted by 1. So first, so second Sunday of January 2020 is 12/1/2020. So if I drag it, second Monday of January of 2020 is 13/1/2020, like that. So second Saturday is 11/1/2020, like that. Okay. So if we change this to 3, so then we will get the third Sunday, third Monday, third Tuesday, like that. Okay. Then if I want to find out the case in February, so just drag it. So it came to the February and it is the case of all days. So I drag it to the whole session. So this table enough will show you the date, corresponding date. Okay. So it uses the computer calendar to calculate these things. And the calculation work is tedious one. So that is out of coverage of this session. So what you can do is copy the formula. Okay. It is there in your Excel sheet, which I have given to you. Okay. So here, instead of manually going to the calendar, we can see this. So if we want after 2020, instead of 2020, if we want 2025, then also it is possible. Just change the year. Okay. So 5 years up after this date, then also we will get the date. Okay. So to make appointment or something, we can use this method very easily. Then calculate work days. Work day is the thing here we are discussing is, you are working in a human resources. When employees start, they are on probation for 50 work days. How can you calculate the end of the probationary period? Okay, so what we are going to use is, okay, so here the employee name, hire date, that is the joining date, and this is a list of holidays. So we have to ignore the holidays. Okay, so ignore the holidays. So probation ends is equal to work day, start date is the hire date. Then after 50 days the probation ends, so I'm giving 50. Then I have to give the holidays list. Close it. Enter. So this first employee's probation ending period date is 28/5/2008. Okay. So before copying the formula, what we have to do is cell referencing change F4. So copy. It will copy to the same thing as done to every cell. So instead of 50, maybe after 1 year, 365 days. Okay. So instead of after 1 year, 365 days, the probation ends. Suppose. So then also we are getting the date. So whatever, what we have to do is number of days should be given here. Okay. And give the cell referencing and copy the formula. Okay. That is the use of workday function. So it calculates working days. Then looking up an exact value based on left lookup column. Okay, that is we have a employee details. So whenever I'm giving the employee name, I have to get the whole things. Okay. So the explanation is like that. The data shows a table of employees. You want to fill out a simplified pay stub form by pulling the information from this table when an employee's ID is selected. Okay. And the corresponding functions are given here. It is also there in the Word file which I have given to you. Okay. So, employee information. So, this is the employee details. Okay. Employee details. Employee ID. Okay. So, I'm giving the employee ID as 665. Okay. 665 is this employee, that is Kaylee Woods. So employee name came automatically. What we have used is VLOOKUP function. So first I have given L3. L3 is the employee ID which I have given. Okay, so I have to look up for this employee ID in the whole table. Then comma, where I have to look up? The range of the whole table, that is given as $B, $3, colon, $I, $12. That is the range of the whole table. Then, comma, if we found this employee ID, what I have to give? There is the second column. Employee name is needed there. So, 2. And exact matching is needed. That is, so that's why false is given. So Kaylee Woods came. So check hash, the number, check number. Then net pay is M7, that is payment. So this payment also have done using this VLOOKUP values. VLOOKUP function. So VLOOKUP can be used in so many ways. Here also, this for in order to calculate the payments. Okay, so payment of the Kaylee Wood. What we have done is VLOOKUP. Okay, VLOOKUP the employee ID in the whole table, and I have to take the fifth column. What is the fifth column? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The salary, fifth column, divided by, I need the fourth column, that is frequency. Okay, so fifth salary by frequency, that is a total salary. Okay, so total salary divided by the frequency is the payment. Then M7 into VLOOKUP. There is a corresponding tax. Okay. So the here also the calculation. I'm just explaining you. The first one is tax. 541.93. So Cayley's tax is calculated like that. There is M7. M7 is the payment of Cayley. Then O8 is the insurance amount. Then O9 is the retirement payment. Retirement. Then, so I have to subtract all these things from the payments into VLOOKUP. VLOOKUP, using VLOOKUP, I am taking the sixth column of Cayley. That is the sixth column is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tax rate. Okay, so I have multiplied the net payment with the tax rate also. So we got the tax as 541.93. Okay, and the total, just summing these three values, and the net payment is M7 minus O11, that is the total deductions. This is the net payment, and this thing gives the deduction values. So by subtracting pay amount, then total subtractions, we get the net payment. Okay, so we have used a number of functions here. Most of the useful thing is the VLOOKUP function. Okay, so whenever the employee ID is changing, it will calculate the things automatically. So when we come to the employee ID 451 also, it calculates it. So it eases our day-to-day life work. So that comes